Good morning. Today's topic is going to be about euthanasia. Okay, so I have had my arguments and it's cost me a friendship, two friendships over the last 2 years that I've had this dog. We bought Carly on June 24th, 2014, and right away I noticed that she was not well trained. Actually, she wasn't trained at all. She didn't know how to sit, so you look at her and you tell her sit. She just looks at you with her tail wagging like, what? She did not lay down. She did not do anything. She wasn't potty trained. So I went through all this effort to me, my dog, and my daughters all took the effort to train this dog because, well, we had her, we bought her during the summer, and it was stressful in the beginning. I was calling my vet, setting up places to go, getting her in to see a vet, because my first vet appointment was free, and then I would listen, I'd ask, because I had no idea, this was our first dog, I was under the impression that if I got a dog, and sorry about the lighting, it's partly cloudy outside, this was my first dog. I had no prior experience other than my parents' dog. But a parent's dog, a dog that's at your home, but your parents mostly take care of it, really isn't you learning to deal with how to, it's you learning how to deal with having a dog around, but it's not you learning how to care for a dog. It's like you can be a daycare worker working at one of them daycare places, but when it comes to rearing your own children, you don't have a fucking clue until you actually do that yourself. It's the same kind of concept, or at least that's my experience with it. Somebody else might have a different, experience, which to me, that's cool. That's cool. We all have our, but anyway, I'm way off topic. But anybody who knows me also knows I also have ADD. So I don't usually stay on topics for very long, and I don't script these. These are not scripted. This is just all raw video. This is me. Blah. if you were to have a conversation with me, this is how it would go. But anyway, back to the topic of Carly. Okay, so it was stressful for the first couple weeks having Carly. I had to look up videos on how to train puppies, because every dog video I looked at had already assumed that the dog knew basic commands. So I said, okay, fine. I'm going to just teach her like she's a puppy. So I got her on one of them small little leashes. I bought a hands-free leash and kept her. And every time I would move somewhere, she would go with me. She was on a leash all the time during the day, in the house. She was with me the whole time. She moved, I knew, I looked. She did anything, I looked. That's how I did it. And that's how they say you're supposed to teach a dog how to be in your home. You don't just give it free rein of access to everything in your home right away. No, you keep that dog within eye visit. And I was, trying to figure out places where I could take her out to go potty. I mean, these are all things that I had to learn on my own. We were going to take her in the front yard to go potty, but then we started, and then we bought one of those. They're like these long spike things. It has a little cap like this, and it's got a little hook. And anyway, you drive that thing into the ground, and then you buy these little lead things. You hook one end onto that little hook that's down into your, into your grass. And then you hook the other part to her leash. Well, and that became our outside outlet for her. So whenever we had to, I had to take her out to the potty every hour for her to associate outside in that area being the area that she has to go potty. I mean, these are things I had to do. My husband just took everything for granted. Like he expected that you know, all the stuff that I was doing every day, training her, taking her out to pee every hour. I was diligent at this work. I mean, very dedicated to teaching this dog how I want her to act in the home. And it worked wonderful until my husband came home. But we're gonna get to that later. We're talking on training yet. Okay, so I would take her out there every hour. Sometimes she would go, sometimes she wouldn't. And sometimes she'd have an accident before the hour. And then I would say, "Hey, you gotta tell me when you gotta go potty." So then she would go outside. I would go clean it up. And then she could come back inside after, because if she potty during the cycle of 1 hour, I would just let her stay outside for that 1 hour. And then I would bring her in for the next hour. Then I would take her back outside for an hour, you know, for the, let's see, she'll go, and then bring her back in for another hour and then go back out. I mean, eventually they learn, "Hey, this is what you want me to do." And you know, I give her praise and give her a good pat on the back and tell her she's a good dog for doing what I wanted. And oh, I'd get that tail just. It was probably one of the most wonderful joys, aside from child rearing, that I've ever experienced. The joy of teaching my dog how to do things. It was wonderful. Now, none of this stuff came easy. I had to learn everything the hard way. I mean, I was researching left and right on websites, looking up videos, just any resource I could find. I had this friend that was a rescue. She did rescue animals in her home with her mother. I would get lots of information from her, and I took everything she gave me. And I did it to heart. I used every bit of knowledge she could give me. When she asked, you know, she gave me advice on behaviouring because Carly wasn't well behaved. She wasn't used to people, you know, actually petting her and being, you know, she wasn't used to having people let her be around other people. The people who owned her kept her in a kennel. They bred her in a kennel. They let her keep her puppies, and I'd imagine they hosed her down to wash the kennel out because she does not like the water hose. She probably got the broom a lot because when I would sweep, she would tuck her tail and run. She didn't like the vacuum, so she must have had some issue with vacuums, or maybe she just, maybe being an outside dog, just never associated. She doesn't like the vacuum either. But you know, these are all things that I had to learn really early on, that Carly was very psychologically abused as a puppy up until 4 years old. Who has a dog and doesn't care for it for that many years? I can't fathom. If you did that to a human person, your kid would be in CPS so quickly and you'd be in jail. But it's perfectly normal for a dog. I mean, I don't want to be all animal right activist because quite honestly, I'm not an activist. And I'm definitely not in animal rights because I love me some deer meats and stuff. But anyway, that's not quite, you know, the same thing. But anyway, it's really frustrating that I had to do all this stuff. Me and the girls, me and my two daughters, did this every day. We would train with her. I did most of it because I could tell that, you know, my younger daughter and I were the ones that did her simple tricks, like getting her to lay down, getting her to sit with the, you know, using around her dinner time when because Carly is a very motivated dog to food. She's a food motivated dog. So oh goodness, excuse me. So she responded well to treats. So we would give her little tiny kibbles as a, you know, I'd give her one or two, you know, you can't just give her one because, you know, whatever. But she liked it, even if you gave her one accidentally. But that was her reward system. But only for a little bit, you know, once you get established what you want, giving her a reward, Then you start just giving her praise and petting her and calling her a good girl. And you do all that. And then she just learns to associate your praise as being, you know, the accomplishment, the thumbs up. Okay, so I was doing all this stuff with her for, I'd say, the first 6 months. My husband was at work, and then he'd come home, and he'd just throw all of my training right out the window. He would let her roam around without the leash on, so she'd go in places and go pee or poop. She only pooped in the house a couple times. She's only done that a couple times. So it's mostly just pee if she pees in the house. You know, if she does anything in the house, it's usually just pee. But she generally did them when my husband was around because he didn't try to train her. He didn't actively do anything with her. He would criticize me if I went to scold her for behavior that she knows that I don't allow her to do, but my husband did, then that just put a mixed signals for the dog, and she would aggressively bite me, and break my skin and various other things, and or just nip. But those are behaviors that I just dismissed right away. So I dismissed all of those things, and this went on for, you know, another year. So now we're into a year and a, you know, year and a half. So this is early this year, and the behaviors are still the same. She acts a certain way when me and my children are around. She's good. But then once my husband comes home, she's instantly licking the floor. She's jumping all over him. She's peeing, excite peeing at him because he, oh, good dog. Hi, how are you? Picks her up and cuddles her, even though she's like just peed. You know, he treats her very, I don't know what the appropriate word is, but it was very stressful for me and my children because he would say that we weren't trying hard enough, that we were being aggressive with her. And I said, it seems like we're being aggressive because you're being very anti anything. I mean, like, she would come home, and I would read up on what. Okay, how do you stop the dog from jump, jump, jump? I mean, she's only 9 inches tall from foot to head, so she's not a tall dog. So she's a short and a long. So she's a beagle wiener. So she's got the wiener body long, and then, you know, the wiener body short too. But she looks like a beagle. But anyway, so she would jump up on him, and I would continuously tell him to turn away from her, to ignore her until she calms down, because she would excite pee and then get in trouble, and then she had to go outside, and he would always say that we were being bad. We were being the bad people for it. He's just not getting anything. I mean, my dad would keep saying, don't do anything with the dog, you know, don't do anything. I mean, if he wants to just, he thinks that you're being a bad owner on teaching your dog, then just let him try to do everything. So anyway, around February of this year, my daughter and my husband were sitting upstairs in our living room on the couch. She was doing some math homework, and the dog was upstairs, and I was downstairs, probably watching a recorded show. Anyway, then I hear, oh, Carly bit me upstairs. So I pause my show and I come upstairs. What's going on? And my husband is sitting there scolding my daughter for Carly biting her. And I said, just take the dog outside. And then she just grazed her skin. She only grazed my daughter's skin on her leg or on her ankle. Apparently, my husband had been ignoring the dog, and the dog wasn't liking it, and, you know, because he was trying to help my daughter with her homework, and so she nipped at my daughter's leg, or my daughter's ankle, and We sat down and seriously had a talk because she had been biting like this for a while now, biting to get my husband's attention. She bites whenever anybody, she's aggressive whenever when anyone else is around. Like if he's holding her and we want to come and pet her, she'll raise her teeth and lowly growl. And if you're not paying attention because you're like in the middle of a conversation and you reach forward to, like anybody would who, has a dog, they'd, be having a conversation, reach forward, pet the household dog. If you're not paying attention, but behavior, our vet had suggested months before this that we needed to see a behavioralist. And when I talked to one of the behavioralists, she said, if your home life is where three of your members are doing the same thing, but you have one that isn't, that confusion makes the dog more aggressive. And no matter what you do and how many behavioral classes you take, it's never going to work if that one person isn't on board with your training or the agreed upon family training. And this is the same thing that friend of mine who does rescue, she kept telling me the same thing. And I kept saying, I know. And it was putting a strain on our relationship. And was putting this whole thing has been putting a strain on my husband and myself's marriage. And it's just because he wouldn't listen. I mean, it's not like I was trying to be overly aggressive and saying, okay, you can't do this. You can't. No, it just was very basic guidelines like, okay, when you come home and she's jumping, just turn away, don't acknowledge her. And he wouldn't listen for a whole year and a half. He would not listen for however long, but he wouldn't listen. Or she nips at somebody because he's got her in her arms, or she's near him and somebody wants to sit down next to him. Or if, like, my family roughhouses, okay, we play roughhouse, we'll wrestle or, tickle or, close body contact, like any family does. I mean, I'd assume every family has, little, not real fights. They're not, nobody gets hurt. It's just, Anyway, when we're roughhousing, the dog is always there, barking, and if it gets too, if we keep ignoring her, if he keeps ignoring her, then she starts nipping at people's pants. And if we didn't have pants on and we had shorts on, she'd be nipping at our legs. And that behavior was the first sign that we have to do something. And my husband just kept ignoring it. He just kept saying, "You're too aggressive with her." And he would not believe that it was his inability or unwillingness to go with the training that I was giving him. I was giving him information. I gave him video links to how to, do certain things. Like if the dog is being visibly aggressive to other family members, I did videos on those. I sent him links on reading articles, blogs, various things. I would give him every tool possible, and he just looked at me like, "You're the one that needs to be less aggressive with her." And I'm said, "I'm not being aggressive. She is, because you're allowing her to be aggressive, so she thinks it's okay." So back to when my daughter got bit from the homework incident. So I sat down as a family and I said, "She does it again. She's gone. We have to put her down." The vet tried telling us, back in like a year, in our first year of having her, I kept telling the vet, I said, "She's biting us. And, she's biting me. She's bitten me twice already and broke my skin twice." And that's in the first year. And that's just because I was trying to, go to pick her up to take her outside because she peed around my husband. And she would turn right and bite me. Like I said, those are things that I, as a person, had never come to be accustomed to. I had never experienced that kind of dog before in it. But okay, anyway, so we sat down as a family and I said, "I can't do this. I can't keep around a dog that you're not willing to help train and do all this that, do things that you need to get done." And so just 11 days ago, well, actually, on May 10th of 2016, she bit me again. You can't see it anymore because it's healed, but you can see this part because she bit right here and right here. You can't quite see it. Oh, and then she also bit me here. So she bit me twice in one night, but they're both healed now, except, you know, the thing that's on my... And it's still sensitive to the touch right here. Too bad you really can't see. I do have pictures of it, but like I said, I went to pick her up because she peed, and she just her. And I don't know. I guess I just wanted her to get her out of the way because we were actually trying to teach her roll over, just to roll over, and she just squatted right there and peed right in the middle of where we were trying to train with her. And we're like, no, you know, that's not going to, no, don't do that. Or, so then we go to pick her up. And that was the intention, was to pick her up and bring her down, you know, bring her outside, put her on the thing outside so we could clean it up. But as soon as, "Ow, Carly, you bit me," she ran downstairs to my husband and he cuddled her like, "Oh, big old mean mommy was scaring you." Oh, and I don't like being called my dog's mom. No. She may be my dog, but I am not. I don't have fur babies. I have dogs. Dogs are part of the family, but they are not my babies. I spoil her, but I don't consider her a baby. She may be, well, I may have called her my little fur, or, you know, I may have called her my little furry, but I never... I don't like being associated with fur baby mom, or, you know, and she's not my baby. I didn't squish her out. But that doesn't mean I don't love her. That just means that that's just a title I don't. I mean, that's like mum. I don't like being, I don't want to ever be called mum. It's just one of those, it's like that. It's like, I don't want, when I'm a grandma, don't you dare call me mama or nana. No, it's grandma. Or grandma. That's it. Don't call me nothing else. But, you know, it's in that line. It's not that I don't see her as that. It's just that's my preference. But she ran downstairs and I said, "Take that dog outside." I said, "I'm done. We're going to call the vet and I'm going to, put her down for euthanasia." And she's gone. I'm going to make my appointment for euthanasia. He did not speak to me that night. He knew he was mad at me because I said that. But at that meeting in February, I said, "If she bites again, she bites and breaks skin on a human again, she's gone. I don't want to keep dealing with this. I can't. I don't. My kids are already afraid. Every time that she's around she's around my husband, my kids are weary of petting her. They don't want to be around her. So like my husband thinks it's normal that, okay, well, I better pass the dog off this way. So that way the back is facing, you know, very carefully, and then say, "Hey, no, you can't do that." You know, like, okay, that dogs don't know that kind of crap, but, or maybe they do, but this dog doesn't, acts like she doesn't know. You know, when he says, "No, don't do that," and he pets her, to me, that's just saying, okay, you're just basically saying that it's okay to, you know, do the action you were just doing because you're positively reinforcing her by petting her, giving her the stimulation. She doesn't know your words. You know, I mean, she doesn't, I don't know. Anyway, so he didn't talk to me the rest of the night on May 10th. And ever since then, I texted my dad that night, and he's like, "Well, looks like it's time to put your dog down," because he knows that what all the struggles that I've been going through. Oh, and I lost the friend, the one that was the shelter that worked for that was a rescue, and her mom. The lady plastered all of the stuff that I was not willing to openly talk about with my friends. None of them wanted to talk to me about how I was dealing, how much struggles I was dealing with the dog issues. This lady was the only one that I talked to, and she said, "No, you don't listen to anything." But I got mad at her because she accused me of not listening to any of her advice, and I listened to every single thing. But because my husband didn't, she yelled at me about it. Like, I can tell my husband what to do, you know? So I lost her as a friend because her mom started saying, how dare you act like that to her? She's been nothing but kind to you. We have not been nothing but kind to you. And I got pissed. I was like, you don't talk to me. You've never talked to me about dog stuff. Don't sit there and act like you're a saint. I said, I listened to every single thing your daughter had to give for advice. I tried my best. And I said, you want to sit there and throw my struggles back in my face? Fucking unfriend me. I was so pissed. So she unfriended me. So I unfriended the other lady, and I saw that she started following me, and I looked through my follower stuff, and I turned that shit off. I don't have follower except I don't accept followers anymore on Facebook because of that. I realized the girl, the rescue lady, was just trying to be helpful, but when she has started attacking me and saying that I was not listening to her advice, I got mad because I listened to everything. My heart hurt when she said those things, and I don't let a lot of people into my heart. Doing these videos and talking to YouTube is a big step for me. I never allow people into my, you know, a lot of my friends aren't very supportive of me. None of them supported me on any of this dog stuff. They didn't want to listen. They didn't want to be around. Nobody was there for me. So, yeah. I don't really have any support system anymore, but for the last, since May 10th, and it's May 24th now, I think, or something like that. Anyway, this has been so difficult for me. My dad told me, if he wants to keep the dog, and if he wants to cancel that, so I made the appointment the next day to put my dog down, and through the whole conversation when the vet was telling me about what to expect when you know, take your dog in to put him down, I couldn't stop crying. I mean, in the vet, I went in, I spoke to the vet so many times. There, it's on paper that Carly is aggressive and getting mixed signals from my husband's inability to train with the dog. So, I mean, this isn't new to my vet. I mean, they had suggested the last time that I bit, or that she bit in February, that I should put her down. But against my best judgment, everybody in the family then was pissed at me because I just said I couldn't, I don't want, I personally, as a person, do not accept any dog biting a human. That is not an acceptable behavior. Not at all. You do not let a dog who bites humans into a home with other humans. To me, that is a no. That's a line that I personally can, that's like somebody who is a firm believer in God and somebody's talking to him about changing the religion. It's the same thing for me. I am a firm believer. I cannot. It breaks my heart. I mean, I love Carly. I have given Carly everything. And my dad advised me, if my husband wants to just ignore training, or, you know, ignore my advice, don't do anything with the dog. And ever since she bit me, I have done nothing. I said, that dog's, I'm done with the dog. I don't take care of her anymore. I don't feed her. I don't take her out of her kennel, even though I know she has to pee. And she looks at me like, I gotta pee. You know, I know she has to do these things, but I'm done. I can't do it anymore. Am I a terrible person for that? Probably. But this has been a struggle of mine for almost 2 years now. This is an emotional struggle. Dogs do not bite humans. I cannot have that liability in my house. And I've had people call me a murderer because I considered euthanasia for my dog. That's all I gotta say. Fuck you. You don't know my life. You don't know the struggles I've gone through. Hopefully with this video you might, but I'm not a fucking murderer. I tried, I gave this dog my love, and I can't do it anymore. I can't watch her bite another, you know, my family member, my daughters again. I can't watch her do it. If I leave to go to the grocery store and I get a phone call within 5 minutes of me getting to the store, Mom, the dog bit so-and-so again, bit so-and-so, and then they show you pictures of the dog bite on their arm. I don't want those kind of phone calls from my own children calling me just because I happened to forget one thing for supper and I had to go to the store to go get it quick before I started supper. I just can't do that. And people calling me a murderer, that's not very fair of you. You don't know my situation. But it breaks my heart that I have to ignore this dog. I just had to tell someone. I don't know. I don't know how I'm not crying right now, but it has been a struggle to ignore the dog. I want to take her out. I want to take her for walks. I want to do these things with it. I mean, I did not buy a dog, did not do anything with it. But this is what I'm left with because my husband, and then now he treats me like, well, you're the one that wanted to put her down. You need to take her out. And it's like, no, you want to keep around a dog that bites, you know? And now it's putting a strain on our marriage. I mean, I don't know where this is going to end. I'm really trying to follow what my dad says. And if he wants to be, you know, he wants to be the dog's master, then he can be the dog's master. And ever since I stopped feeding the dog, the veterinarian suggested with the size of dog she was that a third of a cup of kibble is a good amount for her to stay a healthy weight. As soon as I said, I'm done feeding, I'm not feeding her, I'm not giving her flea and tick and heartworm medicines anymore, he started giving her two of scoops of food because he always said that my dog was too thin. And the vet would always say, your dog is a perfect weight. Perfect weight. You know, it's sad that people associate dogs at a perfect weight being too thin because they associate overweight dog as being a healthy dog. And I never thought anything of that because until my husband started taking care of this dog. He has not given her flea or tick or heartworm medication this month. And yes, it's on our little reminder calendar, so all of our phones get it every month on the same day, because otherwise I would have forgotten. So it's on the calendar, it's a reoccurring event. And he let her kill a baby rabbit while he was on a walk. And then I told him, I was like, you gotta take her to the vet, make sure she doesn't have, you know, fleas. She didn't get any other excuse me. She didn't get any other diseases. He didn't do any of that. So I said, because I knew he wasn't going to do anything about it. I wouldn't have bought some deworming pills. So I did that. The doses, you give her two up front, and then you give her two, I think. I did it like you would, like a human. When you do a human deworming, you all take the deworming pill, and then seven days later, you take it again. So I did that with the dog, and that was the only thing that I've done with her since she bit me. Because I don't want her. I don't want her giving us worms because of his inability to tell the dog no or hold that leash back. I mean, I got a retractable leash, but that doesn't mean that I let my dog just roam free. No, when I did walks, that dog had a short leash, and if she was really good halfway through the walk, I would actually let the little clicker go, and she'd still just walk with me. But if she tried to run, to go catch it, you know, because she's part beagle and a dachshund, so she is going to do that towards rabbits or squirrels, or she used to do birds, but not anymore. So as soon as she darts off, click. I lock her in place. She knows she's not, you know, there were certain boundaries that I had that she knew I had, and she was perfect about it. She didn't mind. And anyway, this video has gone way too long, but that has been my struggle. And I might make a video later about Oh my God, I'm sweaty. It's very humid in the house. I don't have any air conditioning on yet. I just got my windows open. It was very humid last night, and I should turn a fan on because, whew, just standing upstairs, it's really humid. And I was gonna go outside and read. I got a letter to write, but I hope this enlightens some people. But euthanasia should never be considered murder. Sometimes it's the person's last resort. If Carly got cancer, and instead of, years of taking medications and being in pain, I would opt to just put her down. I would love that option. If I had end stage cancer, I don't want treatment. If the treatment isn't going to work, I would like to go out peacefully, just let me fall asleep and never wake up again. I have always agreed with humane euthanization. It's just, I mean, if don't let somebody suffer in pain. And I'm emotionally suffering because, and so is the dog, because of one person not wanting to train with the dog. This isn't easy for me. This has never been easy. And to have somebody so close-minded to just call me a murderer without knowing any of the story, that's not very fair. I always used to think that I was pretty fair. Well, no, actually, I used to be very flip you off, don't care about your opinion. But as soon as I became a mom and more enlightened in age, nice way of saying I've gotten old, but hearing both sides of the story is a lot better. But I've got to end now. So, okay. Bye.